Didn't keep area students from taking center stage at M&T Bank Stadium yesterday. Middle school flag football teams took to the field for the Baltimore Ravens' first ever youth football camp. Director of Player Personnel Eric DaCosta helped guide the youth through a series of drills to develop their offensive and defensive skills. The student athletes ended the day with a tour of M&T Bank Stadium, including an up-close look at the Ravens' game day locker room. What a thrill. Hundreds of players packed the Timonium Fairgrounds for the 2011 annual LAC Splash. The players, who range age from 7 to 14, get an opportunity to play one last time before summer ushers in a new sports season. WBAL-TV is a proud sponsor of the annual event, which has served as a year-end celebration for youth lacrosse. LAC Splash wraps up later today.
And it should be nice out there.
There might be a little bit of rain out there, but I wouldn't cancel. If I was going to do something like that, I'd still go.
Yeah. Right. A little rain can't hurt us. Well, that's all for us at 6. 11 News Sunday morning. Are we going to do weather?
Should we?
I believe we're going to do more weather. I'm sorry.
Quick weather.
I didn't know we were doing weather, but
that's
I'll do it for you guys if you want. A mix of sun and clouds, a 40% chance for a shower or a thunderstorm today. The high temperatures between 80 and 85. Next week, it's going to get hot again. For those of you that really like the steamy weather, it'll be back. I'll show you the 7-day forecast in just a few
minutes. Can't wait for that.
I know you can't. Yeah.
But that is all for us at 6. The NBC Today Show is next.
Yeah, and Sunday morning continues WBAL Plus. If you want to check us out there, that's 11-2 over the air, Verizon 460 and Comcast 208. Have a great day.
We'll see you.
This is a WBAL TV 11 editorial from President and General Manager Dan Jarrus.
Since 1999, LAC Splash has been a year-end celebration for youth lacrosse. It has hosted more than 50,000 players from all over the Mid-Atlantic. Baltimore and Harford County fields are packed with players aged 7 to 14, getting the chance to play one last time before summer ushers in new sports seasons. Maryland's love affair with lacrosse stretches beyond calendar boundaries and has deep roots in our community. In fact, the first women's lacrosse team in the United States was established at Bryn Mawr School in 1926. Over Memorial Weekend for the second year in a row, thousands of Marylanders packed M&T Bank Stadium for the NCAA Men's Lacrosse Championships. You have to look no further than your own backyard to see the sport played with true passion. If you're interested in learning more about youth lacrosse programs in our community, or this year's Warrior LAC Splash tournament, just log on to WBALTV.com.
Live, local, Late breaking. This is WBAL TV 11 News Sunday morning.
Welcome to 11 News Sunday morning. I'm Lisa Robinson.
And I'm Sarah Caldwell. Our top stories in just a moment. First, we want to take a look outside with meteorologist Tony Pan. And we've had a little hit or miss showers there.
Yeah, we've had a little bit of rain out there. It's not the kind of rain, again, that's going to make you cancel outdoor plans or anything like that. Shower will come through, it'll drift away, and then the sun will come out. So about a 40% chance you'll see something drift through your neighborhood during the day today. Let's take a look at HD Doppler, and we can see some of the rain out there already. Just a quick shot of rain going through the northern part of Baltimore County right now, heading down towards Towson and Cockeysville. That'll move into Baltimore City probably by 7:30 or so. And then it clears out upstream from there in southern Pennsylvania. So, again, these will just be passing quick showers. The forecast for today, a mix of sun and clouds, that 40% chance for a shower or thunderstorm. The high temperature right around 83. When we come back in just a few minutes, we'll take a look at the seven-day forecast, see what's on tap for the work week. For now, to the news desk.
A top al-Qaeda leader believed dead this morning after a U.S. drone strike near the Pakistan-Afghanistan border. A Pakistani intelligence official says Ilyas Kashmiri was killed Friday.
U.S. officials are not confirming the death, but it comes a little more than a week after Secretary of State Hillary Clinton was in Pakistan attempting to patch up frayed relations in the wake of the bin Laden raid. 11 News reporter Brian Moore has the latest.
A top al-Qaeda leader and potential successor to Osama bin Laden is reportedly among nine people killed in a U.S. drone strike in northwest Pakistan. Though the Pentagon is not yet confirming the death, Ilyas Kashmiri is high on the list of most wanted terrorists in Pakistan. He is said to be responsible for several attacks on U.S. forces in Afghanistan and the accused mastermind of the Mumbai massacre in India that killed more than 160 people in 2008.
Money flowed through his hands. Training was done at his behest and his direction. He was the field supervisory effort of al-Qaeda, and getting rid of this guy is really, really important and makes both Europe and the United States much safer.
Kashmiri's death is being reported by local Pakistani officials and by his followers who vow to take revenge on the United States. The killing of Kashmiri is seen as a serious blow to al-Qaeda and the Taliban. But another U.S. strike within Pakistan's borders also threatens to strain the already frayed relations between the two countries.
Brian Moore, WBAL-TV 11 News.
President Obama will meet with his national security team on Monday to talk about Pakistan and Afghanistan. Meantime, Yemen's vice president has reportedly taken over as acting president and supreme commander of the armed forces. This comes after the country's president, Ali Abdullah Saleh, suffered injuries in a rocket attack on his presidential palace yesterday. Saleh has reportedly arrived in Saudi Arabia for treatment of his injuries amid increasing pressure to step down as Yemen's leader of three decades.
A gunman is still on the run after an early morning murder in East Baltimore. It happened in the 500 block of North Decker Street back in mid-April. But police still don't have any leads, and now they're asking for your help. 11 News reporter Sheldon Dutez has more.
Even though it's been 6 weeks since Donnie Lopez was murdered on North Decker Street, neighbors still remember it as if it were last night.
Roughly sounded like about a Desert Eagle. We just heard the noise, and then we came around the corner. By the time we got around here, the ambulance and all that stuff was already out here.
It was just somebody shooting. And the next thing, we heard the sirens and everything, and I couldn't believe that there was a body over there.
Police say 26-year-old Donis Lopez was shot and killed by a high-powered gun around 3:30 in the morning. The Honduras native had been living and working in Baltimore, but friends say he sent that money to his family back home. Although police don't have any witnesses or suspects, they've speculated on the circumstances of Lopez's death.
Police feel like the victim and the suspect may have known each other. I mean, to have been hit that many times and at close range, it was definitely a crime of passion, if you will. But we do believe somebody else was out there other than the victim and the suspect.
No leads at all? Wow, that's crazy.
Homicide detectives hope anyone with information will call them, but neighbors are less optimistic people will come forward.
Not many.
Why don't people talk?
They're afraid. I mean, you listen, if you say too much and you end up being a witness, you're liable to be a victim.
Sheldon Dutez, WBAL TV 11 News.
Hundreds gathered yesterday to say their final farewell to the 12-year-old victim of a quadruple shooting. Funeral services were held in East Baltimore yesterday for Sean Johnson. Johnson and his three teenage friends were shot back on May 24th as they sat on a porch in the 1700 block of Cliffview Avenue in northeast Baltimore. Johnson, who was shot in the chest, died 2 days later. No arrests have been made in that case.
The search for suspects continues after a deadly shooting in northeast Baltimore. Authorities say officers were called to the 2200 block of Fleetwood Avenue around 10:45 Friday night. When they arrived, they found a man suffering from multiple gunshot wounds. He was rushed to Bayview Medical Center, where he died. Police have not released the name of the victim, and there's no word on a possible motive. A woman is recovering after police say she was attacked by a dog. It happened around 5 o'clock Friday evening in the 700 block of Ponca Street. That's in Greektown. Sources say the dog was taken into custody by animal control. Investigators have not released any additional details about the incident. No word today on the victim's condition.
The Department of Transportation has issued a cease and desist order after the bus company involved in a deadly crash reportedly tried to sell tickets under different company names. The Sky Express bus company was shut down after one of its buses crashed Tuesday, killing 4 people and injuring more than 50 others. Online records show that Sky Express buses are now listed under 108 Tours and I-95 Coach, but company staff deny any knowledge of the other listings.
Online, this bus is called I-95 Coach.
Yes.
But here it says Blue Sky Bus.
I'm just working for Blue Sky Bus. I don't know what is I-95.
The Department of Transportation has subpoenaed the owner of the websites to gain documents about the buses and the bus companies.
And the time is 7:06. It's 65 degrees on TV Hill. Coming up, our favorite celebs are wearing them. How you can steal the Maxi dress look.
I think I need to get some height first. Plus, sleep apnea is a dangerous condition, but a new surgery may be able to rid people of the problem. We'll talk to a doctor about that procedure.
But first, you're looking at a live picture from SkyCam. Tony Pan is up next with your InstaWeather Plus forecast.
And a programming note, Dr. Carla Hayden, executive director of the Enoch Pratt Free Library, will be our guest later this morning on 11 News. If you have a question for her, go ahead and send it in. Email the questions to sundayquestions@wbaltv.com. Again, that's sundayquestions@wbaltv.com.
Now, your 11 InstaWeather Plus forecast with meteorologist Tony Pan.
Morning, everyone. The time is coming up on 10 minutes after 7 o'clock. It's 67 degrees at the airport, 70 downtown, partly cloudy skies, and a little bit of rain showing up in some neighborhoods. Let's take a look at HD Doppler. We can see some rain drifting down out of Baltimore County and Carroll County this morning. This is nothing of any consequence, but you might hear a rumble of thunder as this passes by in Towson or Cockeysville, Westminster, some light rain showers. These are moving to the south, so they'll move into Baltimore City probably within the next half hour or 45 minutes. Let's switch it over, take a wider view here of this system. If we look upstream, everything's moving south to north. If we look upstream, we see a little break there in southern Pennsylvania. So after this batch of rain goes by, we probably will get a break and then maybe some more redevelopment as we head into the afternoon. And of course, with the showers around, you have a lot of at least high thin cloud cover out there. Even if you don't have some rain in your neighborhood, you probably have some cloud cover drifting by. So we'll call it variable clouds or a mix of sun and clouds during the day today. These storms are developing on the boundary between a hot and steamy air mass that's in the Plain States and a cool and comfortable one up in New England. And that boundary is going to be going back and forth over the next couple of days. Eventually, we're going to get back into the steamy weather, but probably not until the middle of the week. 63 in Westminster right now. It's 66 in Rock Hall and 64 degrees in Rising Sun. We should make it into the low 80s later on today. So a mix of sun and clouds, a chance for a shower or thunderstorm. Not a steady rain, though. Don't cancel your outdoor plans. The high temperature right around 83. And then a chance for some rain this evening, clearing up overnight. Temperatures will drop back into the upper 50s and low 60s. Sunset at 8:30. During the day tomorrow, the boundary will go a little further to the south, and high pressure will take control coming out of the Great Lakes. And that means some nice weather for the start of the work week on Monday with comfortable humidity. Now, eventually, the warm air will work its way back into the mid-Atlantic, but probably not until the middle of the week. So 82 tomorrow, 85 on Tuesday, 91 or 92 on Wednesday, and then another front's going to come through with some scattered thunderstorms Thursday and Friday, and that should knock the temperatures back closer to average with a high near 83 on Saturday.
Thanks, Tony. Tourism officials are trying to make it easy for you to find things to do in Maryland. A new guide out this month offers dozens of ideas and money-saving tips. 11 News reporter Jennifer Franciotti has more on Destination Maryland.
Torsk is a late World War II submarine. She's a Tench-class submarine. She carried a crew of about 80 people on board. It's actually one of our most popular attractions.
Part of the historic Ships of Baltimore tour at the Inner Harbor, the Torsk is just one of hundreds of attractions featured in Destination Maryland. This new addition from the State Department of Tourism is an all-inclusive guide to hot spots to visit in Maryland.
From Mountain Maryland to here in the Central Region, Southern Maryland, the Eastern Shore, and the Capital Region around D.C.
The magazine is divided by region with descriptions of what there is to see along with hotels in the area. And depending on what you like to do, you can find out where to go to do it. If camping's your thing.
It is one of our major attractions. We have great cabins at state parks. We have campsites. We have private campgrounds. Beautiful places.
The magazine is filled with helpful information, detailed sections on events going on in a region so you can plan your visit. And in the back, any tolls you may face, road signs you can encounter, and Maryland traffic safety laws.
Big part is our Maryland Passport program, which is available in here. You can see all of the 250 locations across the state that offer over $3,000 in savings.
Chris Rosum is the executive director of the Historic Ships of Baltimore. He says the magazine gives residents and tourists a great resource.
It's another porthole through which people can find out that the ships are here and that they're just a fantastic resource for people to visit.
Jennifer Franciotti, WBAL-TV 11 News.
Destination Maryland is free, and to find out how to get a copy, go to our website, WBALTV.com, and click on As Seen On. And still ahead, long flowing dresses are Hollywood's latest trend. Dress Barn is here to show you how to get the style.
But first, is sleep apnea is a dangerous condition. A local doctor joins us with a new procedure to help those who suffer.
And the Aberdeen Ironbirds are giving away a once-in-a-lifetime experience for Father's Day. Find out how you can take part next.
Do we think we need anything? Okay. grade and got busy. I'll turn her down.
We'll have. It's singing. It's
Zebovitz.
Zebovitz. Okay. And then that gets blown out.
Yeah, Z. Most people just said Z.
They have this. This will be up on the screen.
Okay.
Like if you're experiencing job questions to ask.
He is close.
And
yeah.
To see if
right,
you
Lisa,
have
you
sleep apnea.
You slide over a little bit. There you go. And no, you.
Yes, and I'll just sort of. It'll be up on the screen. I'm just going to walk. Okay. So let's talk about some of the questions.
Are you up too
you should ask
high?
If you,
you want
need to get surgery.
Go down a little. In the
I think
chair.
I'm okay.
There you go. Better.
Okay. So I'll say you know. Questions to ask if you need this particular surgery.
Uh-huh.
Okay. If you're experiencing all these things. And I'll say, okay, so I'll make, say the one and you'll explain what that means.
Okay. And I'm supposed to be looking at you, yeah. Not the camera.
Sleep apnea is a disorder with abnormal breathing. It can be dangerous. It can also lead to a number of other serious health problems. Joining me now, Dr. Edward Zebovitz, to tell us more about a jaw surgery that helps people with sleep apnea. Welcome.
Well, hi, Lisa. How are you?
I'm good, thank you. For those who don't understand, what is sleep apnea?
I guess for people that, and we may all know people that when they're sleeping, they snore or actually have moments where they actually stop breathing.
Right.
That's sleep apnea.
Sleep apnea. Okay, so let's talk about. There's a groundbreaking new surgery.
It's a newer procedure. Newer procedure. But basically, we've been doing it for many years,
okay.
And it's kind of modified it to use with sleep apnea now.
Mm-hmm.
And it's all about the issue with sleep apnea is that they just don't have enough room in their airway. The airway is very small.
Okay.
So with that in mind, we're just. Mechanically or actually increasing the dimension of the airway so they have more room to breathe.
So this is is this less invasive as it's been in the past? Or no?
It's probably.
It's pretty invasive.
It's improving. Okay. But probably the key to it is really, it's an adjunct for those that have the other techniques that have been used in the past, aren't working, they can't use them, things like that. And for example, the CPAP, which is a machine that basically blows air down the nose of the mouth to keep the airway open. A lot of people, and basically up to about 70% of people, can't wear it.
Okay.
So with sleep apnea and high blood pressure, diabetes, increased incidence of stroke, these are major health issues that if they can't use techniques or the devices at this point, then they need an alternative.
Right. And so the surgery is doing what? What are you... Is it the uvula or?
Well, in the past, and one of the procedures was to trim the soft palate, the little punching bag that sits in the back. But we found that really didn't all that successful. Probably less than a 30% success rate.
Mm-hmm.
So we found that that's not a great one.
Okay.
But this one's actually, if we think about the back of the throat, it's made up by the back of the throat and the tongue. So, and the tongue's attached to the lower jaw.
Mm-hmm.
So one of the things is we move the lower jaw forward, or lower and upper jaw in some cases.
Mm-hmm.
And by doing that, we make the space bigger.
Wow. I didn't know it was going to be all that. Okay, so let's talk about some of the questions to ask to see if you need this particular surgery. So as people are thinking about it. And one you say is if you're experiencing jaw pain.
I guess we find that people that have sleep apnea also have a high incidence that they clench and grind their teeth at night. So what we found is those people, if we address their sleep apnea, they actually grind and grit less.
Mm-hmm.
So that would be helpful for them.
Okay. So then that means that your bite can be off and you may have pain chewing and things like that?
Exactly. So we also find that kind of jaw deformities are also related with bite problems.
Mm-hmm.
So that can also be associated with it. So.
All right. And startling at night?
Yeah, I guess the thought is if you've ever, and I often ask my patients, you ever sleeping and then wake up startled?
Uh-huh.
And the thought is that a dream? Is that you falling out of bed? No, it's actually probably
is that
an episode.
Somebody pushing you out of the bed? No, okay.
Elbow in you.
Okay.
But it's actually probably you have an episode where you actually stop breathing for anywhere between 10 and 30 seconds.
Wow.
And with that, your body says, wake up,
right.
Because breathing's the most important thing we do.
Mm-hmm. And being fatigued, I guess, throughout the day, is that another symptom?
Exactly. So the thought is if you have these little episodes where you are awoken every, and it's sometimes up to every minute or every two times a minute, mm-hmm. you never really get refreshed sleep. Even though you went to sleep, you never really, you know, you're not getting good quality mm-hmm. sleep. So.
And I guess the other issue is your partner always in the other room?
Yeah, so the thought is if you're the person that goes to bed later than your bed partner, then you're listening to this loud snoring.
Right.
So therefore, you don't fall asleep. Or it's kind of scary to be able to, or to see somebody stop breathing. So Right. It's really scary stuff.
And you know what? So couples go back and forth over this because a lot of times the person who's doing the startling and the snoring, and they don't believe it.
Thank you.
So how do you record them or something?
Well, you know, that's part of it. Or formally we do what's called a sleep study. Mm-hmm. So sleep study helps us determine how bad it is.
All right. And that could be, that will require an overnight stay, mostly.
No, yeah, correct.
Okay, good stuff. Thank you, Doctor.
Thank you.
Dr. Z, if you would like more information about the surgery, you can call 301-352-6311 or check out his website, www.drzebelvitz.com.
Thank you.
All right. And don't go away. When we come back, we'll show you how to get the latest Hollywood trend, maxi dresses. And before you can say you can't pull the look off, our style expert has tips for everyone. But first is a look at some events going on around town. Great.
She's going to mention how pretty I look, too, not just you.
Of course. I have compliments for everybody.
Seriously. I'm hoping that they would make it not necessarily use it for vacation. So if I say that I was going to the funeral and that I would, as long as I have this computer, if you want me to do this stuff, one of the things to do that I fell on.
So we decided they would stand right here. Is that all right? Okay. And they'll stand here and then walk around. Okay? Everybody's good?
Yeah.
All right. Just keep up the pace.
Okay. Well, we got 3 minutes.
Could you count five?
How much do we have total?
I'll find out.
Five, four, three, two, one.
Okay. How much time do they have?
Welcome back. You may have seen your favorite celeb donning a maxi dress, a long, flowy summer dress. Well, Patty Wolf Coulihan from Dress Barn is here to tell us how that style can become a part of your look. Thank you so much for being with us.
Thank you very much,
now,
Sarah.
This is not only for tall people. We've seen them on Jessica Simpson and other celebrities, but
absolutely,
others can pull it off, too.
And we're going to be showing you that today.
All right, let's go through some of the styles.
What we're going to start out with is a solid maxi dress.
Okay.
That is a perfect, great, all-purpose statement.
Okay,
dress.
So pretty much anybody can pull this look off?
Absolutely.
All right.
And our first model today is Frisbee. Frisbee is wearing our everyday look.
Okay.
We have the black solid halter, mm-hmm. and then we have the tie-dye inspired print at the bottom.
really cute
Doesn't
on her.
Doesn't look lovely. Yes.
Yeah, and I think the Empire waist is one of those styles that really works
absolutely
with many different body types.
We also have matched the tote bag with it in the slouch style. Mm-hmm. You want to go with the bigger bag because it goes with the flow of the maxi. As far as the shoe, we're doing little strappy sandals this year.
Okay, that's perfect super. For this time of year. Thank you,
absolutely.
Frisbee. Now tell us about this lovely lady.
Lovely lady Jen. She's wearing our solid black keyhole halter dress, which is also very slimming. As you see the beading through here with the shearing, looks terrific on
that
her.
That looks like one you could wear out at night.
Absolutely.
Yeah. How
absolutely.
Do you feel in that?
Like, wonderful.
Good, good. It looks fantastic
you look
on you. Thank you.
She does.
And then this is a great summer color.
And this is Kim. Kim is also doing this for special occasion. Mm-hmm. It's our safari-inspired print in chiffon with chiffon overlay with a little silk under there as well.
And they're all Empire waist, aren't they?
Mm-hmm. Which
and
is,
I like this right here, the applique.
Right.
Very pretty.
Mm-hmm. It's very slimming. And the halter style, you need to remember, it looks great on everyone.
Mm-hmm. Fantastic. Mm-hmm. Looks good on you. And this is a great color as well. It's kind of a...
Isn't that beautiful?
What would you call it? Like a cantaloupe or...
I would say coral.
Okay.
It's a bright coral. It's in a crinkled rayon. Now, she is our petite model today. And we belted her right here at the thinnest part of the waist yeah. because you want to define your frame.
Okay.
Also for a petite, something you want to keep in mind, if you do a V-neck, it will elongate as well.
Okay.
And what you had mentioned earlier about being shorter, don't worry about it. Just wear a little higher wedge.
Okay.
Today she's wearing an adorable strappy sandal with a multicolor, which really makes that pop.
It really looks fantastic.
Absolutely.
And I like the texture of that fabric, too.
Isn't that beautiful?
It breathes, doesn't it?
Uh-huh.
Yeah, it looks
feels
great.
Good, light, airy, perfect for summer.
All right, let's call everybody back, and we'll take a look at these styles again. And you've given us some really good ideas. Now, not only can we wear these perhaps on the beach, but also to go out at night and on many different occasions. This is perfect. Thank
absolutely.
You so much, Patty. We appreciate the
thank
ideas.
Thank you, Sarah. It was
great to meet you. And it is 65 degrees on TV Hill at 727 coming up. Stay with us. You're watching 11 News Sunday morning. Much more news ahead.
Live, local, late breaking. This is WBAL TV 11 News Sunday morning.
Welcome back to 11 News Sunday morning. Thanks for joining us.
Our top stories in a moment. First, let's take another look outside with Tony.
Good morning, ladies. We have a little bit of rain out there this morning. I emphasize the little bit part of it. This is not the kind of thing that washes out a Sunday and makes you stay home. Let's take a look at HD Doppler. You can see a touch of rain moving through Baltimore County right now, stretching into the northern part of Baltimore City. Those showers have actually been falling apart over the last couple of hours, and I can expect that trend to continue. So just a chance for a shower, maybe a thunder shower this morning. Switch it over, take a look at the forecast, a mix of sun and clouds. We'll put that 30 or 40% chance in for a shower or a thunderstorm. The high temperature right around 83. When we come back in a few minutes, we'll check 7-day forecast and see what's on tap for the work week. For now, to the news desk.
Thanks so much, Tony. Here's a look at some of our top stories this morning. 13 people, including kids, were rushed to the hospital after wind gusts picked up a bounce house with children inside. It happened on Long Island during a soccer club tournament. Some of the kids were burned and knocked down. None of the injuries were serious. Arizona firefighters say they have zero containment of the wildfire that's ravaging that state. The blaze has already burned more than 140,000 acres near the New Mexico border and displaced thousands of residents. Firefighters say they're worried the flames won't stop moving anytime soon because there are no natural barriers to slow them down. Still no word on what caused the wildfire, which is now the fourth largest in Arizona history. Fire has destroyed the Nashville, Tennessee home of country music star Trace Adkins. Adkins is on tour, but his children were at home with a family friend when the fire started. Fortunately, everyone got out safely, including the family dog who bit the neighbor who warned the family of the fire. Fire investigators say the fire started in the garage and spread up the walls to the attic. They have not yet determined the cause.
Groundbreaking scientific evidence in the murder trial of Casey Anthony. Prosecutors presented DNA and actual air samples they say indicate Kaylee's body may have been in the trunk of her mother's car. As Bob Keeling explains, it's science that has never been introduced in a criminal court.
An FBI hair evidence expert testified that a lone strand recovered from Casey Anthony's car trunk, just one strand of hair, showed signs of decomposition.
It has a darkened band at the root portion of the hair, similar to one of the photos in the poster, and this is consistent with apparent decomposition.
And she testified that the hair identified as Q12 could have come from Kaylee Anthony. Her mother's defense keyed in on the fact that this science is inexact.
You still can't say that that hair came from a dead body.
That's correct. It has characteristics that are consistent with that, but I can't say absolutely.
This is my label that I placed on this in this tin can.
A sheriff's crime scene supervisor testified about how he collected odor and stain samples from the car and trash that had been in it. On cross-examination, he admitted taking those samples more than a month after those items had been in evidence.
There is now finally definitive evidence.
Veteran attorney Jeff Dean says the hair is scientific testimony the jury can now hang on to, along with those who testified that Casey's car smelled like death.
I don't think in this jury's mind anymore it's a question of whether that child was in that trunk. The question now for them is why was that baby in that trunk? And there's no good answer for that.
And that was Bob Keeling reporting. The trial resumes Monday when scientists from the Oak Ridge Lab in Tennessee are expected to take the stand to testify. They are expected to testify that their tests came back positive for decomposition.
Police, education, and government were among the topics of discussion at a teen summit yesterday in downtown Baltimore. Maryland U.S. Congressman Elijah Cummings met with some of the city's teens to answer their concerns at the Give a Care Summit. The town hall-style summit was designed to help Baltimore's youth become more engaged in the community. Organizers discussed the importance of having city leaders at the summit.
It's very important for, you know, our students to see that there are leaders who give a care about them. It's very important for them to see that, and so they can see that they're just like them. They're not, you know, a higher being. They don't have any more privileges. They might have more opportunity, but that's their resources to get to that point.
Baltimore City Police Commissioner Fred Bielfeld also took part in the summit.
Still ahead on 11 News, Animal Rescue joins us with a pet looking for a home.
And the Aberdeen Ironbirds are giving one dad a special gift this Father's Day. Next, how you can take part in their contest. Tony?
A little bit of rain showing up on HD Doppler. We'll take a look at that and the 7-day forecast when I come back in just a few minutes. Stay with us.
One, two, three, four,
Jocelyn?
Five.
Jocelyn?
Yes,
okay.
Jocelyn.
And what do you do for the team?
I am the Corporate Partnership Services Manager.
Oh, okay.
It's a long one.
It is. And we are going to talk about the contest.
Father's Day Essay Contest.
Okay. And what else about it?
It's essay contest for 18 and younger, mm-hmm. To write in about why they love their dad or father figure.
Mm-hmm.
They'll win.
Now, your 11 InstaWeather Plus forecast with meteorologist Tony Pan.
Welcome back. The time is 7:36. We have a little bit of rain out there in some neighborhoods. I'll show you the radar in a second. 67 at the airport, 70 degrees downtown. We should make it into the 80s this afternoon. Now, I emphasize the little bit part of this rain shower activity. You got some showers coming through the city, up around Towson, back over towards Edgemere, Dundalk, and Essex. These have been dissipating, actually, over the last couple of hours. They're a lot stronger when they were up in the northern part of Baltimore County. They're moving north to south, so these will be heading down, if they hold together, heading down towards Annapolis and Arnold within the next half hour or 30 minutes. This is not the kind of rain that makes you cancel any plans, though. It'll come through, and then it'll end. You get a little sunshine to break through behind it. Let's switch over, take a wider view here with the system. A lot of activity south of us, some big thunderstorms down in the southern part of Virginia, but if we look upstream, there's nothing going on in southern Pennsylvania. So after this little batch goes through, we should get a break. That's not to say that we won't see some more develop this afternoon, because we have a little boundary just west of us, but at least we'll get a touch of a break. But there's plenty of cloud cover out there this morning, so I doubt if we'll see crystal clear skies. We'll just call it variable clouds or a mix of sun and clouds as we head through the day today. And these storms have been developing on the boundary between the hot and steamy air mass that we were in a little while ago and the cool and comfortable air mass that's up here in the Great Lakes. You see it's in the 40s and 50s across New England there. So that boundary is going to go back and forth over the next few days. Eventually, we're going to get back into the hot and steamy weather, I think, by the middle of the week. 71 in Annapolis right now, 63 in Parkton. It's 65 in Jarrettsville, and we'll make it into the low 80s this afternoon. The high temperature is between 80 and 85. A mix of sun and clouds, and again, that chance for a passing shower or thunderstorm. Same thing this evening, maybe a shower or thunderstorm, and then partly cloudy overnight. Temperatures will drop back into the upper 50s and low 60s. During the day tomorrow, that boundary will be far enough away from us that I think we take the chance for rain out of the forecast. High pressure in control. It should be a nice day on Monday with temperatures in the low 80s, but the heat is going to come back by the middle of the week. So 82 tomorrow, comfortable overnight lows in the 50s, and then we take it up to 85 or 86 on Tuesday, in the low 90s on Wednesday, complete with humidity. Scattered thunderstorms are possible, though, Thursday and Friday as the front goes through, and that should knock the temperatures back to closer to average by the beginning of next weekend on Saturday.
Father's Day is just 2 weeks away, and the Aberdeen Ironbirds are giving one dad prime seats for the team's Father's Day game. Joining me now, Jocelyn Hill, to tell us more about this Father's Day contest. Hello, nice to see you.
Nice to see you.
All right, so tell us all about it. What is the contest?
Well, teens and children age 18 and younger are encouraged to write an essay, 200 words or less, to the effect of why they love their dad or father figure. Then we'll judge the essays, and we'll invite the winner and their dad and family out to the game on Father's Day on June 19th.
Okay, so they have to submit it?
They submit it via email to bmcgee@ripkinbaseball.com, mm-hmm. and then we'll judge them. They have to be submitted by the 13th of June, and we'll judge them on the 17th, and then the game is on the 19th.
Okay, there's the information right there on the screen. It's bmcgee@ripkinbaseball.com. 200 words or less. Handwritten? Does it have to be typed out on the computer?
Typed on the computer would be preferable. Uh-huh. They can also fax. If you want to drop them by the stadium, we'll take them that way as well. I know not everyone has access to email, so you can handwrite them. We'll read them, absolutely. Okay. But we wanted to give an opportunity to honor fathers, the Ripken family philosophy, and how important Cal Ripken Sr. was to his sons, mm-hmm. Cal Jr. and Bill. And so we wanted to spread that out across all of our fan base.
Okay. So if you so what does the winner get?
The winner gets the ultimate Father's Day experience at an Ironbirds game on June 19th. So they'll have the Ripken seats right behind home plate for a game. They can bring up to six people to that. The author and the father will get to take batting practice on the field with the team. They'll have dinner at the ballpark. They'll get a Cal Ripken autographed jersey, mm-hmm. or I'm sorry, autographed baseball, and they'll have personalized jerseys for the author and the dad, and they'll be able to throw out the first pitch right before the game.
That's great stuff. Yeah. So it's only one. Is there a second prize, third prize?
We'll have some tickets and invite some people out for the runners-up, yeah.
Okay. Yeah. All right, so that's good stuff. So the information for the deadline and everything, again, the contest deadline is 5 o'clock Monday, June 13th. You have to be 18 or younger to participate. And you can call at 410-297-9292, but they need to send it in to BMD.
Yes, send it in or drop it off.
Okay. Yeah. Now, before you go, you guys have all kinds of fun stuff planned
for
the summer.
We have so many theme nights going on. Yeah, we open on June 17th, mm-hmm. which is a Friday, and then we've got just all kinds of theme nights, Star Wars night mm-hmm. and superhero night and all sorts of things going on. We have the Bucket Boys coming back and Superstars mm-hmm. and just lots of fun stuff happening at the stadium this summer.
And what about for children? Any particular special programs for kids who love baseball?
Yeah, we have a new kids club. We have Ferris's VIPs, and Ferris is one of our mascots. Mm-hmm. And the Ferris's VIP is kids club is $20. It gets you a hat, a T-shirt, a ticket to Ferris's birthday party with a picnic, access to lots of fun stuff. Like we have the kids zone at the ballpark mm-hmm. and that kind of stuff.
I mean, this is if you love baseball, yeah. it's just a more intimate experience than what you would have if you went down to see the Orioles,
yes,
right?
Yes, absolutely. You're really close to the field. There's access, more access to the players. You kind of get to see them on their climb up to the majors, mm-hmm. and it's really cool in that regard.
All right, good stuff. So we look forward to seeing you out in Aberdeen this summer.
Thank you.
Thank you, Jocelyn, for coming in. Stay with us. Animal Rescue joins us next with a pet looking for a good home. But first, here's a look at last night's winning lottery numbers.
Live from Television Hill.
For the York folks. For the York. Yeah, Jeff is a character.
Huh? Oh my God. Yeah, he's only been here, I think, a few months.
A little less than a year.
Yeah. Yeah.
Bill, could you please give us a mic check?
Testing 1, 2, 3, 4. Testing 1, 2.
Live from Television Hill in Baltimore, WBAL-TV 11 News continues.
Come on, look at that face. How can you not want to take this dog home? Welcome back. Joining us again today from Animal Rescue is Phil Stalins. Phil, you have a cute face too, but
not as cute as that.
Look at that. Introduce us to your friend.
Okay, this is Diamond. She's a female, 5-year-old. She's a shepherd, we think, a border collie mix. She's got very high energy.
Been very smart, you said, too.
She's incredibly intelligent. Be a great dog with a young family. She's got a lot of energy. She loves children. A little bit questionable with cats and not very good with farm animals.
Not very good with farm animals. Okay. Well, this Diamond has made a big impact with everybody in the studio, obviously.
Oh, she's so well-behaved.
She's got a very good personality, very well-behaved, and you would be smart to take this dog home. What's going on with you guys? Got any special projects coming up?
Our big walk is coming up October 1st. I know it seems like it's a little bit early, but we're still looking for sponsors, and we're looking for sponsors and, like say, and also vendors to come to our event.
And all that money goes to support, of course, Animal Rescue. Right.
And last year we had over 4,000 people that showed up at our event.
Outstanding.
It's at John Rudy Park up in York. Pennsylvania. It's a great event, all kinds of vendors, all kinds of good food.
Well, let's put the website and phone number up there on the screen, and Phil, you can tell them how to contact you if they're interested in that, or one of the wonderful
right.
pets you guys have.
And she'll be able, unfortunately, we're closed today, but she'll be there tomorrow, mm-hmm. Monday, Wednesday, and Friday from 1 to 3, and on Saturday from 1 to 4 if they want to come visit.
Okay,
the farm.
You got the website and phone number or no? Mm-hmm. Yes? No? It's, okay, it's 717
993-3232. And our website is animalrescueinc.org.
Excellent. Phil, thank you so much for coming in. Really appreciate it. And Diamond Buddy, you're going to get a call. I'm positive of that. We'll take a look at the seven-day forecast in just a few minutes from now. We'll send it back over to the news desk.
And at 7:46 coming up, we're taking Sunday brunch outside and firing up the grill. So come on back.
A great comeback for the Orioles, and a racing track official does something really stupid. You'll see both coming up in sports.
Strip steak.
You're watching 11 News Sunday morning.
So, should I be in progress cooking stuff when we start? Is that kind of how you want to, should there be things on the grill?
Yeah, you can do that. I mean, we have a good amount of time. I think it's like 3:30.
Okay.
Typically. So, I mean, just go through the process. You can be cooking as you go along.
I mean, mm-hmm. since I have the finished plate done, we can.
Yeah.
Cool.
Doesn't look very complicated.
It's not.
Okay.
Oh, no, it's raining. That's not good.
I know. Look at this.
How are you? Yeah. Andy Little. Nice to meet you.
What else you got?
I have a whole thing of pastries, but when we're finished, how about that?
Oh, yeah. Ooh, that's beautiful.
That meat looks good, though.
That's one and a half. Where's the camera going to be? Here?
Yeah, we can get the camera. That would work.
I have these waiting in and out.
I
know, I'm like, I'm ready.
No. I'll do the camera.
I don't think Joe knows. I saw him wandering around the room.
No, he knows.
I'm serious.
I did.
When you're going
know.
This direction.
Okay, I'm standing here.
I mean, I'll point it at you, but I can't guarantee you.
Testing, 1, 2, 3, 3, 2, 1. Testing, testing.
Now, 11 Sports.
Good morning, I'm Greg Tolan. After losing six of their last seven, the Orioles were in desperate need of a boost. Last night, they got it. First, by activating Derek Lee from the disabled list. Lee had two hits and scored twice in his return, but it was one monster hit by Mark Reynolds that turned the tide in the O's favor. Jake Arrieta on the mound. Jake got rocked in Seattle on Monday. Today he was facing Corey Patterson, the second batter of the game. The former Oriole crushes this pitch to right field, his fifth homer of the season. That gave the Jays a 1-0 lead. Bottom of the second, Bird's down by two. J.J. Hardy with the ground ball. Yunel Escobar with the backhand. He fires to first, getting Hardy. Derek Lee scores. It's a 2-1 game. Sixth inning, bases loaded for Mark Reynolds. Mark goes to the deli and orders the Grand Salami. His first Grand Slam of his career. Couldn't have come at a better time. It gave the O's a 5-3 lead. The bullpen was outstanding. Jim Johnson, Koji Uehara, and Kevin Gregg pitching the final three innings. This is Gregg getting Escobar to pop up to end the game. Orioles win it. Final score 5-3. To historic Fenway Park, the Red Sox were up 7-3 against Oakland in the ninth. Sox closer Jonathan Papelbon in the game, and he blew a 4-run lead. Connor Jackson with a shot off the bag. 2 runs scored. We're all tied up at 7. Papelbon allowed 4 runs in a third of an inning. You know he's ticked. Papelbon gets ejected, then goes off on home plate umpire Tony Randazzo. Bumping Randazzo, manager Terry Francona tries to be the peacemaker. Too late for that. 14th inning, J.D. Drew, base hit. That'll score Carl Crawford. That's the game winner. Sox pull it out. The final, 9-8. In Japan, after finishing the course, Formula One driver Sebastian Buemi did a few donuts to show off for the fans. As he pulled away, watch this, a track official runs in front of his car. Duh, what was this guy thinking? Amazingly enough, the official suffered no injuries. Here's a little advice for this guy. Next time, wait until the car goes by. Just a thought. I'm Greg Tolan. Hope you have a great Sunday.
And it's time now for Sunday brunch. We're outside, a little chilly out here, but it's time to cook it up with Chef Andrew Little of Shepherd Mansion in Hanover, Pennsylvania. Thanks so much for being with us.
Oh, I'm really, really happy to be here.
Yeah, tell us what you're cooking. It smells delicious.
We've got some of our own Shepherd Mansion Farms Highland beef. We have some strip steaks. So we're going to do something really simple and very quick that you could just pop out in the afternoon, maybe, and have a beer and put some food on the table.
Yeah, we're getting you ready to grill tonight, if that's
absolutely
your plan.
So we just put some of these steaks on, and I have some vegetables too. You see, we did some vegetables here a little bit ago. Just some olive oil, really simple olive oil, salt, and pepper, and put them on the grill. So we'll do couple of these.
Can you pretty much do any vegetable that way on the grill?
Pretty much. I mean, any more you can go and you can get these sort of fancy vegetable pans. So if you have something that maybe is a little wily, like the spring onion, could pretty easily fall through. So you get the nice vegetable pan, and it'll help you out.
Or I guess you could just do tinfoil, right?
You could do tinfoil, absolutely.
Okay.
Maybe steam them a little bit.
All right. And what about the meat that you're using?
The meat, this is, we raise our own beef for the restaurant and also for sale. We have a market behind the restaurant in our carriage house. So it's really, really lean. And it, you know, the farm-to-table thing is pretty popular these days. And our farm is about 3 miles from our table, so it doesn't get any closer as far as the circle goes.
That may be a little too close for comfort, actually.
For some people, we really like it. Being able to have that that interaction, we grow a lot of our own vegetables. So it's a really, really fun way to work and fun way to cook.
And I would imagine with this meat being so fresh, you probably don't need a lot of seasoning.
There isn't a whole lot of seasoning. You're going to see, I haven't even seasoned it yet. I'm going to put a little bit of salt and pepper, and that's really all we need. You just want the natural flavor of the beef. You can see we have some finished here. That natural flavor is going to show through. I mean, you certainly could marinate it if you wanted to, but it really sort of stands out on its own.
Now, here's the problem I have when I'm grilling. Things tend to get too dry. How do you prevent that from happening and so you have a nice cut of meat?
Don't have too many beers.
No, is that my problem? Okay.
Make sure that you're standing by the grill and really paying attention to it. I mean, a lot of times you see people, they'll throw meat on the grill and they go mow the lawn and come back and they have these sort of charred pieces thinking, well, my meat's really dry. Well, no kidding.
Right.
You know, your lawn looks great though.
Exactly. So how much time would you recommend?
Yeah, really about 3 or 4 minutes per side.
Okay.
We're not going to fully be able to, in the spot here, we're not going to be able to get it fully cooked, but it doesn't take much longer than the time we're going to have right here.
All
and you
right.
can see we're already starting to get some nice cooking lines on it.
All right. And as far as the vegetables, about how long are you grilling those?
About the same. The nice thing about the vegetables, especially if you have a grill like this that has this sort of upper level, you can put things up here to keep them warm. And you can see we've also finished some steaks over here. Just slide by here real quickly.
Yep.
One of my favorite things to do, and this also sort of speaks to your drying out, butter is better in general. So if there's a fixer for anything, once the steaks are come off, we just sit them in a little bit of butter and continue to baste them while they stay warm. It is fattening, and it's delicious.
We like fattening. That's fantastic. So and it keeps it from getting dry.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. Well, let's make sure people know how to get a copy of the recipe. Log on to our website, WBALTV.com, and click on food. Or you can send us a self-addressed stamped envelope to Sunday Brunch, WBAL-TV, 3800 Hooper Avenue, Baltimore, Maryland, 21211. And what are you going to be cooking in the 9 o'clock hour?
We're going to do some shaved pork sandwiches, peppers and onions, and a little bit of cheese, and one of my favorite beers for grilling, Natty Bo. When you're in Baltimore, you have to have it.
Fantastic. Now, are we checking the forecast this time?
Let's do that here.
Okay.
I'll grab that from you real quick. Let's toss up the 7-day forecast right now. We have a couple scattered showers out there. That's going to be the case through the day today, off and on. If you have outdoor plans, I certainly wouldn't cancel anything. Low 80s, and then nice weather early next week before it gets hot on Wednesday, 91, 92 on Wednesday. So the heat's coming back, Sarah.
All right. Sounds good. Yeah, we'll be back at 9 o'clock for sure, and Chef Andrew Little will join us again. Thanks so much for being with us. Have a great morning.
Follow breaking news and weather anytime at WBALTV.com and stay connected with us on Facebook and Twitter. This is a WBAL-TV 11 editorial from President and General Manager Dan Jarrus.
Since 1999, Lac Splash has been a year-end celebration for youth lacrosse. It has hosted more than 50,000 players from all over the Mid-Atlantic. Baltimore and Harford County fields are packed with players aged 7 to 14, getting the chance to play one last time before summer ushers in new sports seasons. Maryland's love affair with lacrosse stretches beyond calendar boundaries and has deep roots in our community. In fact, the first women's lacrosse team in the United States was established at Bryn Mawr School in 1926. Over Memorial Weekend for the second year in a row, thousands of Marylanders packed M&T Bank Stadium for the NCAA Men's Lacrosse Championships. You have to look no further than your own backyard to see the sport played with true passion. If you're interested in learning more about youth lacrosse programs in our community, or this year's Warrior Lac Splash tournament, just log on to WBALTV.com.